consumer pressure on supermarkets, people saying, I won't buy the product unless you treat the animals better. So there have been quite a lot of changes in these other industries, and very much less change in the fur production industry. One other final comment is, what is the position of Finland? I sat for many years on the Council of Europe committee, and I've been involved with all of the EU scientific committees for 25 years. And in general, Finland is a country which is very progressive in trying to improve welfare, and more progressive than the average country in Europe. However, in relation to fur production, the government representatives from Finland have often been resistant to changes in the past. And it's a contrast. Finland is progressive in most areas and not in this area. So that is a sort of rude comment from an outside person. So, but it is a strange thing that that you have seen. There seem to be different views, and how much it's a public view and how much it isn't, I don't know. You may know that better than I do. But I feel there are some. There is a lot of change which is needed, and it hasn't been happening. So. It seems to be an unsatisfactory situation at the moment. Welfare is too bad in these areas and of mink and fox production. And so here are some of the references which I have referred to, including in the middle the two very 2012 ones, the very recent ones. Okay, I'm very happy to answer questions or discussions if it's useful to you. Thanks.
Onko kysymyksiä?
I thought that in the beginning you mentioned that if the coping is successful, it would mean
yes.
It would be a proof of good welfare.
Yeah.
But I a little bit disagree because people have children in concentration camps and often coping may also be a reaction of being nervous and distressed and so, and even the way they have this coping sort of, it's so mechanical.
Yes.
So,
yes,
so
let me comment on that.
I have thought that it's a similar attitude as people say if cows eat much milk they feel good, and if the fur is beautiful the animal feels good.
This is
not correct.
So what I probably said it too quickly, but in order, if coping is, the coping has to be successful before welfare can be good. But there are some things which you cope with which doesn't mean that everything is fine. For example, you may regulate your body temperature very efficiently, so you're coping with the temperature, but you may be in a very dangerous situation. You're going to be attacked by a predator, or you're in a difficult social situation. So you may cope with one thing, but not with another thing. You have to cope with everything in order for welfare to be good. And what animal welfare scientists are now doing is looking directly for indicators of good welfare, as well as looking at for the negative. And I think this is a very important thing to do. And the reason that it has been happening more recently is that it isn't so easy to make the measurements. But for example, we now have some possibility of using physiological measures. So oxytocin is a hormone which seems to be associated most of the time with good welfare. So maybe there's something physiological. There are various behavioral measurements which give us information of the positive end of welfare and not just the negative. But so I agree with you that there are certainly lots of times when individuals will adapt to a bad environment, but it doesn't mean that the welfare is good. You have to be able to adapt to everything. You have to fulfill all the needs in order for the welfare to be good. And ideally, you should be looking for the positive indicators of happiness, if you like. But thank you for that point.
Thank you.
You can ask it in Finnish and it can, or Swedish, and it can be translated. Probably you said that.
Joo, mä oon eläinlääkäri Taina Haarahiltunen, Suomen turkiseläin kasvattajaliitosta. I'm a veterinarian, Taina Haarahiltunen, from the Finnish Fur Breeders Association, and thank you for your very interesting presentation. and I have some ideas. We have there in the east part of Finland, in the University of Eastern Finland, we have a fur animal scientists, welfare scientists.
Yes, I know.
So maybe you know them and,
well,
and
I know some of them.
Yes, and
four or five.
Yes, during the last 10 years, they have done a couple of doctoral theses.
Yes.
About fur animal welfare. Meillä on Itä-Suomen yliopistossa turkiseläinten hyvinvointitutkimusta ja viimeisen 10 vuoden aikana sieltä on syntynyt useita turkiseläinten hyvinvointiin liittyviä väitöskirjoja, että siellä on aktiivista tutkimusta ja me ollaan elinkeinona siitä hyvin ilahtuneita ja seurataan niitä tarkoin. Sitten mä kommentoisin vielä tuohon esimerkiksi tuohon minkkien uimiseen, että tutkimustulosten mukaan myös on niin, että jos minkki ei koskaan päässyt uimaan, niin minkki ei kaipaa sitä uimista. Että silloin siitä tulee minkille hyvinvointiongelma, jos minkki on päässyt uimaan, mutta siltä sitten estetään se uimaan pääsy myöhemmin. I said some words about swimming and minks.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you.
So, sorry, I'm going to translate if you would like to respond to that. She said that if a mink has never been introduced to swimming water, then the mink would not have a need for that. Do you have and it would not be a welfare problem. Do you have any comments on this?
Yes, in order to do any study like the ones which are described, there are now 3 or 4 studies on the reaction of mink to water for swimming. The animal has to be exposed to the water, otherwise you can't do the study. So that's correct. What we find is that every animal in whichever environment it has been living, when it is given the opportunity to go into water, if it has a period of adaptation to it, after a short while it uses the water. So they do use the water, but there may be a period when they are getting used to it. So it's like an animal which has been kept in close confinement in a small box, and then it is given the opportunity to go outside the box. They have a period when they are cautiously exploring the outside, but once they have got used to it, they use the wider space, they take the exercise. Seems to be the same kind of thing with mink. That is, there is a period of adaptation, but when they have had the adaptation, then they, after they have been able to use the new facility, the possibility to swim, then they show a preference for it. And I think that's the summary of this work done, some here and some in Holland and some in Canada on that subject. So it isn't the case that if you're not exposed, what we can't, the thing we can specifically say is, if you haven't had experience of water, then if you haven't had experience of water after a short period of adaptation, they show a lot of aquatic activity. So I don't think it's right. That's the information which we have scientifically. Is that clear?
Okay. My name is Marko Merilä and I'm a farmer in Aalso, and I think that we have now 33% lesser of the foxes, the cages, and I
yes.
think that is big difference.
Yes.
Because it's 33% is a lot of, and our great cages are much bigger than is the 2 years ago.
Yes.
That is, I think that is big difference. It's looking that it is small, but it's big difference when we speak in the percent.
Yes. There have been several scientific studies, both with mink and with foxes, of what happens when you give them some more space. And if you give them more space and nothing else, then there is a rather small effect on the welfare. But if you have more space, you have possibility to give them more things to do. So you can give them more things to manipulate, tunnels to go into. They have more possibilities to do things. But as well as the additional space, you need the additional possibilities to do things. And this is the same result that you get in other species. So you have do the same thing with pigs or calves, for example. Increasing the space alone has a small effect, but it has the possibility of giving a somewhat richer environment. So, for example, in the work, the Canadian work, which I mentioned by Meagher and Mason with mink, they when they put a tunnel so the animal could go to a double-sized cage. They could put many things in this cage which really did improve the welfare of the animals. So I think the key thing is what you do with the space. But I agree with you that it's an improvement to have more space. A small improvement.
Muita kysymyksiä?
If you would have to choose one thing, one single thing that would improve the conditions in Finnish fur farms,
yes,
what would that single thing be, in your opinion?
So the answer would be different for foxes and mink. I think for the mink that probably having the possibility to have access to water for swimming would make a big difference. It would only be possible if you had significantly more space. So it would go along with more space. But so you would need to have more space and more things to do is what it is. But one of those for mink is to be able to use water. So I think for the mink that's probably the most important thing. And I think for foxes, probably the worst thing is the exposure to other foxes and the inability to avoid humans who are approaching. So at the moment the foxes can't hide. If foxes could hide better, that would improve things. That would mean you'd have to have a means of doing that. Now, there are zoos which keep foxes, and there are zoos which keep mink, and they keep them in very good conditions where the animals are not fearful all the time, and they can, in the case of the foxes, they can hide when they want to, and they do. They hide a lot of the time. So I think you could improve the environment for foxes by having a good method for them to hide, and that might also reduce reduce the extent of infanticide. And the infanticide is really a really clear indicator of very poor welfare. I think if you have a lot of infanticide, that's a very bad thing. But so far, in the fur production industry, the changes have been really small, but people don't seem to have been very adventurous in trying to do something different. And I can understand that there you have to invest in order to do things, but there doesn't seem to have been very much. So you have to invest a bit to increase the cage sizes. I appreciate that, but to try to meet all the needs of the animals, you do have to do more than has been done so far.
Oliko teillä kysymys? Joku? Ei. Näin vaan. Onko kellään muilla vielä kysymyksiä?
Mä kommentoisin vielä tai onnittelisin teitä tästä kansalaisaloitteesta, että olette saanut nimet kerättyä ja olette tosiaan tehnyt poliittista historiaa siinä mielessä. Ollaan elinkeinona tyytyväisiä siitä, että käytätte tämmöisiä demokraattisia keinoja sen sijaan, kun aiempina vuosina on tehty pahaa turkistiloilla eläimille ja tuottajille. Me arvostetaan tätä some words about the memories. I congratulated them that they have done a good job with the name list. They have done a political history in Finland.
Mm-hmm.
And we are happy that it's a democratic way.
Yes.
It's a wrong way to go to the farms in the night time and make harmful things there.
Yes.
So we are happy that they are doing it this way.
Yes, I think that I agree entirely with that. I think that to go to a farm and, for example, release animals is a very bad thing to do. But actually, I think all kinds of activity nowadays need to be transparent. It needs to be possible for the consumers to know what is being done. So it should be possible for somebody who wants to buy a particular product, and it's an animal product, to know what is happening on the farm where these animals are being produced. So farms need to be open to visits, and there should be possible to see, here is a video of what happens on a farm, and an honest one, that this is really what happens, not just this is the best farm, but this is what happens. And I think there is now a lot more demand from the public to know what really is happening and not for it to happen behind closed doors. So if you have a more open system, then it's going to be more acceptable. And it means also that the worst places are likely to disappear, because the best places are more likely to survive in that circumstance.
Onko vielä kysyttävää? Jos ei... Eli päätän tämän tilaisuuden nyt vielä muutamalla sanalla sitten tuosta turkiseläinten suojelua koskevan lainsäädännön kehittymisestä. Elikkä sen lisäksi, että kansalaisaloite tullaan käsittelemään eduskunnassa, niin tällä hetkellä Suomessa uudistetaan koko Suomen eläinsuojelulakia, ja sen lisäksi maa- ja metsätalousministeriö on aloittanut turkiseläinten pitoa koskevan asetuksen uudistamista. Eli pyritään vaikuttamaan myös näihin lakiuudistuksiin sitten niin, että ne on mahdollisimman hyviä turkiseläinten kannalta. Sen seurauksena, että nyt keskustelu on noussut turkiseläinten pidosta, niin muun muassa Maaseudun Tulevaisuus teetti gallupin siitä, että mitä suomalaiset ihmiset ajattelee turkiseläinten pidosta. Ja gallupin tulos oli se, että vain 1/4 suomalaisista hyväksyy turkiseläinten pidon sellaisissa olosuhteissa kuin missä turkiseläimiä tällä hetkellä pidetään. Reilu 1/2 ihmisistä joko lopettaisi tarhauksen tai sitten hyväksyisi tarhauksen ehdollisesti, jos eläinten hyvinvointia niillä tarhoilla parannettaisiin nykyisestä. Ja kuten tässä Donald Broomin esityksessä kuultiin, niin paljon hyvinvointiongelmia on nykyisillä tarhoilla, ja paljon olisi kehitettävää, jotta eläimet vois niillä hyvin. Ja toivomme, että tämä suomalaisten mielipide siitä, että asioita pitäisi kehittää tai sitten tuotanto pitäisi lopettaa, niin tullaan huomioimaan kunnolla siinä lainsäädännön kehityksessä, ja että poliitikot huomioivat tämän mielipiteen ja saadaan sitten yhteiskuntaa taas kehitettyä eläinten kannalta eettisempään suuntaan. Kiitos.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yes, that's great. That's very nice, yes.
And this is some specific. It says in English what it is. It's non-alcoholic drink.
Great. No.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.